Hello, aviation enthusiasts, Sky here, and we are returning to the world of historic Soviet planes. Our today's hero cannot boast of some incredible flight performance, size, or luxury. This is a fairly average plane in all respects. But as we already know, it's the heroes like these that end up ruling the world. In today's video, we are taking a tour through both the history of this plane and through the plane itself. Get ready for takeoff. Ilyushin IL-18 is a four-engine turboprop passenger aircraft developed by the Ilyushin Design Bureau in the mid-1950s. It is one of the most popular Soviet passenger aircraft, which in its time opened the sky to millions of people. I said that the IL-18 was created in the mid-1950s, but our story is twisted in a loop, since the plane actually appeared in the 1940s. An unusual trick, but at that stage of the industry development, the usual things were pretty rare. We travel into the summer of 1945. The history of the Third Reich was finished. The Soviet Union was preparing for a campaign in Asia. Japan was still maintaining heat in the region, and the US Army was developing new arguments to calm them down. The end of the war in Europe and on the territory of the USSR gave rise to a new renaissance, one of the symbols of which was the recently launched IL-12. This small piston aircraft, accommodating about 3 dozen passengers and flying 1100 kilometers or 600 nautical miles, was supposed to replace the outdated Li-2, and over time became the main passenger transport in the USSR for the coming years. At this time, the Soviet aircraft industry was concentrated around one critical task, the task with an Index 2-4, the first Soviet strategic bomber. The atomic bomb became the main weapon, and while the Soviet nuclear scientists were working on creating their own device, the aviators threw all their efforts into creating the transport for it. A huge amount of effort and resources devoted to this work was supported by several American B-29 bombers lost on the Soviet territory during the war, which became a real technological treasure. The industry was developing at an incredible pace, mastering many new abilities, and for a lot of experts it was quite obvious to use these innovations not only for creating the tools of the apocalypse, but also for more peaceful purposes. The Design Bureau, under the leadership of Sergei Ilyushin, was considering the possibility of creating a whole family of passenger planes, the junior of which would be the twin-engine IL-12 for local transportation, and the senior, the four-engine IL-18, for medium and long-haul routes. The aircraft, with a takeoff mass of 47 tons, accommodating 66 passengers, received a large fuselage with a fully pressurized cabin. 4 brand new Asha-73 piston engines with 2300 horsepower lifted all this beauty into the sky. The plane made its first flight in the summer of 1946. It showed itself pretty good, was quiet for its size, and was controlled without any difficulties. But its life was not long. The IL-18 used a large number of technologies developed during the creation of the bombers. This required the allocation of resources not only from the Design Bureau, but also from the industry, which at that time was limited. The 2-4 was an absolute priority, and it was forbidden to interfere with it. In addition, despite the good performance, the plane would be difficult to master by the airlines. Besides, in the 1940s, there was no particular need for such dimensions. In addition, despite the development of production of many systems, their reliability was not good enough for massive operations. And so, the decision was clear. Not to spend insufficient resources on production of the aircraft that were not particularly needed and had a high risk of crashes. The decision was voiced by Joseph Stalin, so no one was arguing. IL-18 was decommissioned. A little later, work was stopped on its counterpart, the Tu-70, also a passenger plane created on the basis of the Tu-4. In face of the risk of a nuclear war, priorities were set clearly. It would seem that the story of the airliner ended on this. But the end of the 1940s, and especially the 1950s, became the era of revolutions in the aircraft industry. The core of these revolutions was, of course, the emergence of new types of aircraft power plants, jet and turboprop engines. After appearing on the military planes and in a variety of experimental aircraft, these engines quickly moved to civilian aviation. Already in 1948, the British Vickers Viscount, the first turboprop passenger aircraft, was lifted into the sky. And a year later, in 1949, the jet engine came, taking the de Havilland Comet into the air, also British. Yeah, the misty Albion was on top at that time. Vickers produced more than 400 of its aircraft. The Havilland turned out to be not so lucky. However, the advantages of the new engines were obvious. Other countries quickly joined the race of jetliners. USSR, USA, and France directed serious resources to catch up with the British. As a result, soon the sky saw the Tu-104, Caravelle, and the Boeing 707. The Tu-104 was a huge leap for the Soviet aviation industry and an example for many subsequent airliners, primarily those created at the Tupolev Design Bureau. With a flight speed of about 800 km per hour and a capacity of about 100 passengers, this aircraft was impressive in its performance. However, it also had problems. The plane was very demanding to the airport infrastructure, quite difficult to pilot and very expensive to operate. Many ports of that time could not accept it. Moreover, its flight range, from 2100 to 2700 km, was insufficient for many long routes. So, despite the priority of developing a jetliner, it was obvious that the Tu-104 would not be able to handle all of air transportation by itself. It became clear that another plane is needed, close in capacity but simpler both in production and operation. Initially, it was assumed to create a universal civilian aircraft that could carry out both passenger and cargo transportation. This plan was implemented by the Antonov Design Bureau that created the An-10, a four-engine turboprop high-wing aircraft. Ilyushin, however, was against total unification and defended the idea of creating a full-fledged passenger airliner that would be more efficient. In the mid-1950s, he began to realize his vision. And here, the legacy of the old piston IL-18 from the 40s turned out to be very handy. During the development of the new machine, the experience of the old one was used widely. Due to the existence of the bases, Ilyushin engineers were able to significantly optimize the process of the aircraft development. What can I say? The creation of the aircraft was ordered in the spring of 1956, and the first prototype took off in the summer of 1957. Everything in just a year. Nowadays, this much time is being spent on approving project roadmaps. The new aircraft inherited the name IL-18. But of course it was impossible to simply reproduce the ancestor. New realities required new solutions. First of all, it was the power plant. Piston engines gave way to turboprops. Since we're finally looking at the actual plane, I think it will be easier to do in person. In this matter, the Moscow Aviation El Dorado, the Air Force Museum in Monino, will help us once again. Shamelessly ignoring the slender ranks of gorgeous airplanes, we come to the edge of the open area, where the plane awaits us. So, IL-18V, tail number 75737, born in 1961. Was operated for almost 16 years in the Leningrad Air Squad, arriving to Monino in 1977. Today, it will tell us both its own story and the history of its entire breed. The main innovation of the new aircraft are the engines. Piston motors were replaced by turboprops. Why turboprops? The plan to use this kind of power plant pursues several main goals. The fact is that such engines are much more economical than the jet engines, which allowed both saving on fuel consumption and, more importantly, increasing flight range. The IL-18 could fly at a distance of up to 6,500 km or 3,500 nautical miles, a lot more than its jet counterparts. In addition, losing to a jet engine at high speeds, turboprop behaves much better at low speeds. This made the IL-18 more versatile and less demanding to airfields, unlike the jet models. The aircraft received turboprop engines of two models at once, the NK-4 and AI-20, both with about 4,000 horsepower. The competition between the Kuznetsov and Ivchenko engines was serious. Both engines were completely new and very advanced. But at the initial stage of test operations, it turned out that the NK was nevertheless inferior. It had problems with reliability. Eventually, as the main fiery heart of the IL-18, was chosen the AI-20, which after many upgrades also became the basis of the power plants of some Antonov and Beriev aircraft. The engines were equipped with four blade propellers. They have an additional function, a thrust reverse system, capable of changing the angle of the controllable pitch propellers when the blades are set to a negative angle and direct their thrust forward. For the aircraft that was supposed to work on short runways, this was very handy. The engines are integrated into the wing on its upper plane and stick out forward quite a bit. These solutions were very successful. The aerodynamics of the airframe was good. The forward-mounted engine nacelles simplified maintenance, and their high location made life easier for the ground services. The propeller, 4.5 meters in diameter, required space so as not to scrape the ground, and such a scheme allowed not to raise the plane too much. For example, the two 114 engines are installed low, like on its basis, the 295, but it also had a low-mounted wing. As a result, it's not just very large itself, but because of the need to raise the propellers, the whole plane stands on an elongated landing gear. A video can hardly show how tall this airliner is. Despite the engines getting moved forward, the engine nacelles are extended over the entire width of the wing. To improve aerodynamic quality, the exhaust zone has a rather interesting design. The nacelles of the second and third engines are slightly enlarged, but more on that later. Of course, the aircraft designed to fly to not very well equipped airfields received an auxiliary power unit. It is located in the tail section, but stands in a slightly unusual position, across the axis of the fuselage, so the APU exhaust is visible on the right side. New engines were able to achieve new flight performance. The cruise speed on the piston IL-18 was about 450 km per hour, while the new plane was easily reaching 625 km per hour, or 337 knots. Naturally, new speeds made adjustments to the requirements of aerodynamics of the airframe. Its general layout in principle remained the same, an all-metal monoplane with a low straight wing and classic tail. However, the wing was seriously redesigned for new flight speeds and new engines, and received a new, more efficient mechanization. Thanks to all the improvements, the wing behaved well on all flight speeds. The tail was completely new. The 1946 aircraft was structurally very classic for its time, and its empennage was no exception. But the new flight speeds demanded corrections, and the IL-18 received a relevant tail. Major changes in the design of the fuselage were applied to the nose section. On the piston IL-18, created under the influence of 2.4 and B-29 designs, the nose fairing and the cockpit were inscribed into the outlines of the nose section, forming a seamless cockpit design. But at high speeds, such a round nose would generate strong resistance. So instead, the aircraft received a more modern nose, with a cockpit glazing, classic for a 1950s aircraft. Ilyushin did not share Tupolev's love for glass navigator cabins. In the nose of the IL-18, a radar was placed under the fairing. The landing gear has three legs, also a classic scheme for the period. The main gear is equipped with four-wheel bogies. The legs are integrated into the engine nacelles number 2 and 3, the ones closer to the fuselage. That is why they look bigger. The gear doors are also quite curious. Three sections at once, the largest in the front, which opens upon retraction and release, and two small ones next to the leg, quite complex in shape. In general, the IL-18 has a lot of such things, which is unusual since it is considered to be a very simple aircraft. The front leg is equipped with two wheels and is also reinforced. At first, the pilots were playing around by landing on it first and then on the main gear. The leg, of course, can rotate, the commander has separate controls, although most of the taxiing was still carried out through changing the engine's thrust. The most successful solution of the piston IL-18 was the fuselage. It migrated to the new model without major changes. It was a very good solution to apply the round windows instead of rectangular ones. Each window is composed of two glasses of a rather large diameter. The outer glass repeats the shape of the fuselage, while the inner one, intended primarily for holding pressure, is slightly curved, forming the shape of a bowl that improves its strength. The pressure in the cabin was supported by the air conditioning system, which was also created for the old model and improved here. The fuselage dimensions also turned out to be optimal since the 1946 model. Plus, the already inherent possibility of wide customization made it possible not only to quickly create a cabin for the IL-18, but also to modify it easily in the future. Now we can finally go inside our plane. So, in 1958 was created the IL-18B version, with the AI-20 engines, increased takeoff mass, and without some problems of the first series of aircraft. But in 1960, the IL-18V version appeared, the model to which our aircraft belongs. Its interior was subjected to a strong alteration, received more efficient sound insulation, and was redesigned. In its noisiest parts, passenger seats were replaced by auxiliary functions, wardrobe and a galley. These solutions were very helpful. With all their advantages, turboprops are noisier than jet engines, which is not good for comfort. Later, in 1965, another option was created, the IL-18E. Its layout is somewhat similar to the cabins of modern low-cost airliners. Minimum comfort, maximum capacity. Up to 120 passengers in a cabin, with the number of rows increased through reducing the seat pitch. Even with all the improvements, this plane was a bit too tight, and did not gain popularity. Only a few dozen of them were delivered. In the same 1965, the IL-18D entered service, with the modernized 4,250 horsepower AI-20M engines, additional fuel reserve, and a maximum range of 6,500 kilometers, or 3,500 nautical miles. Takeoff weight reached 64 tons. It was much more popular and was produced until 1969. Okay, let's look at the cabin of the IL-18 on the example of our Model V. The cabin has three parts. First, a small one in the front, accommodating up to 20 passengers. Behind it is the galley, located in the operational plane of the propellers. Next comes the main cabin, accommodating up to 55 passengers. It is separated from the third cabin by another auxiliary area with the tail door. The third cabin accommodates only about 14 passengers, a small room. However, this room was considered more comfortable. It is the farthest from the engines and separated from the rest. The layout for a fuselage of this width is quite classic, 5 seats in a row with the 3+2 scheme. On our plane, however, we did not find this scheme. The restored part of the cabin is equipped like an airplane for the VIPs. By the way, in 1961, Yuri Gagarin became one of them. After the first space flight, it was the IL-18 that delivered him to Moscow. But even without the VIP elements, the interior was very good. The luggage racks were not lockable but solid, creating a functional ceiling overhead. Every seat received individual lighting and ventilation, a tilting back, and a removable table. Now all this of course is not impressive, but in the 1950s it was cool. In general, you can clearly feel how much Ilyushin's engineers tried to make the plane as comfortable as possible for everyone who would be using it, from crews and ground services to the passengers. They were not trying to create something insanely cool, they were simply making a good plane. As practice had shown, they succeeded. In the cabin, we also find a baby cradle suspended under the ceiling. This is a tribute to a rather curious story that happened on this plane, when, at the moment of landing, there were more people on board than at the moment of takeoff. It's actually a famous story, when flight attendants had to deliver a baby during the flight. By the way, the engineers made some interesting bonuses for the cabin crews as well. Well, enough walking around the cabin. It's time to see how all of it was controlled in flight. The crew of the IL-18 is composed of 5 people. The aircraft commander in his place and the co-pilot sitting on the right, as expected. In the center is a folding chair where the flight engineer sits and controls the central panel. Trim taps, autopilot, and engine control mechanisms. An aircraft radio operator sits behind him on the right. He has his own table, 2 radio stations, several panels for controlling some of the aircraft systems, and even a device for transferring Morse code. The navigator sits in the back left. He also has his own little table, as well as a complete set of equipment to carry out his work, including of course radio compasses and radars. The cockpit is quite spacious, although it wasn't too easy for 5 people to fit in here. The dark cockpit, when almost all the lighting is turned off at night to give the crew visuals on what's happening outside, also has an interesting execution. Since it was too difficult to illuminate all devices individually, and substances that could always glow were radioactive, they used special paint that glows in ultraviolet light. The cockpit remains dark, while all the inscriptions, panels, and scales are clearly visible. But while it should be dark inside the cockpit, outside, during takeoffs and landings, it is preferable to have some light. Here, the landing lights come to rescue. They are retractable, similar in design to headlights from other airliners, like the supersonic 2144, which we've already visited. The headlights on the plane are bright, to say the least. In operating mode, they have a power of about 1.5 kilowatts, which means that a single one of these lamps is most likely more powerful than all the lamps in your house combined. Naturally, the temperatures are also high. These lamps are designed to be cooled down by frontal wind during takeoffs and landings. Okay, moving on with the story. The brand new IL-18 made its maiden test flight on July 4, 1957. Several machines equipped with the NK-4 and AI-20 engines took part in the test program. The aircraft started civilian operations in 1959. IL-18 became one of the first Soviet turboprop aircrafts and turned out to be one of the most successful and popular. Deliveries of the passenger IL-18s began in 1959 and lasted 10 years. It remained the main airliner in the USSR until the creation of the Tu-154 and IL-62 models. About 700 units were produced in total. In addition, the simplicity and low demands of the aircraft allowed it to gain wide distribution around the world. Beside the basic passenger versions, many cargo, special and military modifications were created, including the IL-38, the anti-submarine naval patrol aircraft, and also the electronic reconnaissance aircraft IL-20. Such popularity of a civilian aircraft in some military functions is easily explained. All the goals set for them require sufficient reliability and the ability to perform long-lasting flights. Meanwhile, the high-speed performance was not crucial. Actually, the same conclusions were made overseas. The four-engine turboprop P-3 Orion is loved by the sailors of the US and Japan. More than 700 of those planes were delivered. For a special marine aircraft, the figure is huge. Despite the fact that its civilian basis, the Lockheed Electra airliner, was not popular. During its operations, the IL-18 was involved in more than 100 incidents, including disasters leading to death of about 2,300 people in total. In this case, taking into account the statistics, the low demands and simplicity of the IL-18 sometimes played against it. The aircraft was often used in harsh conditions, while being operated quite roughly. The plane continued operations until the beginning of the 21st century, having outlived all of its peers, both Soviet and foreign. Commercial operation of the IL-18 in Russia was completed in 2002, but the aircraft continued to fly in some other countries. The military versions are also still flying as part of the armed forces and special departments. Most of the civilian planes are now retired, turning into monuments and becoming museum exhibits, like our today's board in Monino. Okay, that's all for today. Don't forget to like and subscribe to the channel. Fast flights and soft landings to you.